Hi, this is Nick with Solo Music Academy with another song breakdown. Today I'm looking at the melody of What Was I Made For by Billie Eilish. I think this melody, as I had a closer look at it, is a masterclass in the power of repetition. And I think this is a great masterclass in themes and development of ideas and small variations of those key themes. So let's get under the hood, have a closer look, and see what makes this song so awesome. We already have, like, in the beginning here, an allusion to the main melody.
I used to float, now I just fall down. I used to know, but I'm not sure now.
Okay, so I used to float. We got this. Right, so, and then we got a... So we got this A kind of theme, and then this B theme. I'm going to call it B theme for now because it's slightly varied from the A. But they share so much in common. So they kind of go up with the semitone movement. Da, 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 da. So this B to C movement adds to kind of that, like, sad lilt. And then everything falls down. So I used to float, A. Now I just fall down, B. Then we go, I used to know. Which is returning to the first, the A theme. And then,
but I'm not sure now.
So A, B, A, B. And then we got this next phrase.
What I was made for.
So all of these notes are close together, and there's a lot of, like, semitone movement between the E and the F, right? And so this adds to this fall and this kind of, I think, very sad, the overall sadness of this tune. Right? So I'm going to call that theme C, right? What was I made for? What was I made for? Yeah, so we've got these three right out the... In the first verse, we have three really strong themes. We have theme A, which is the... Then we got that variation of it with the theme B. A, B, A, B. And then... Theme C. Which adds to, like, I believe, in my opinion, that, you know, if we heard A, B, A, B... A, B, A, B, we might get bored, but, like, by going away to a new theme makes each of the themes stand stronger, right? So that, like, we're not getting bored. So there's repetition and change. I really love it. Let's go to the next bit. Here's our theme B. Back to theme A.
Turns out
okay, so the second verse, melodically, is almost a carbon copy of the first. Some key differences here is in our theme C, where just the amount of words that Billie is putting into the just something you paid for inherently puts a little bit more rhythmic density in the melody, but the overall notes that she chooses, it's still happening over the D, E, F. Right, so that's still happening over the D, F, and E. So it's more dense, maybe adds to the urgency of the melody leading up into the chorus. And then we have the, what was I made for? So we have one small variation, literally just one note of the I made for. Right, so it's just this extra lift. So I think this is really... beautiful and super powerful songwriting, where we just change one note for a moment And so the overall shape of that phrase feels the same, but also my ears have been given something fresh. Really cool. Okay, so now we're going to this new section, this chorus. And now it's a complete departure from the main themes. So I'm going to call this theme D, right? Or the chorus theme. The shape of these phrases, 'cause I don't know how to feel. Right? I mean, she's so good. I love listening to her. Anyway, in this chorus, in theme D, there is a lot more of a drifting away from these main themes. And there isn't really a strong, like, here is like this short melodic fragment that we repeat. Like, if we go back. This is the first time that we hear like some sort of melodic repeat in the chorus. I don't know how to feel. But even then, it's not a carbon copy. It's the overall shape with a couple of notes. But then she throws in some runs and some variations. So it's not super repeated, but we hear the shape again. So in the chorus, Billie has a lot more freedom to kind of like lilt and have this like melody that just keeps falling and falling and falling, which adds to kind of the sad tone of this song. And I like the variations that she throws in on each of these choruses, because I think it's a nice like opposite to the deliberateness and the repetition used in the verse patterns. Let's go back, or let's continue. We're hearing more repetition in the chorus through her words and this kind of returning question than in the melodic phrases themselves. The key similarity in these chorus melodies is that they always come up, they climb, and then they fall. And they always, everything falls down. Everything falls down in this melody. Let's continue. I'm not sure if you pick up on that, but there's that, the piano mirrors that melodic theme again, just for a moment, which I think is really, really cool, and a nice songwriting decision from both Billie and Phineas. So in this third verse, we again have this A-B theme, and it's pretty much a carbon copy of the first verse. I think what makes this melody come back and not be boring for how much we've repeated it is maybe the fact that the instrumentation around it has now evolved. There's a little bit more energy in the track behind them. And also because of the freeness and the floatiness of the chorus. So it's given me time to kind of refresh my ears. It's not what he's made for. What was I made for? Over there she does the variation where she goes up to the G note. Was I made for? We go to chorus. What a run. So completely a variation from the first chorus, but we've got the overall shape, and then some more improvisation, some runs happening from Billy, which I think is really awesome. I really like the fact that she's kind of using the first little bit of the phrase as a launch pad for something fresh. There's a repetition and then improvisation afterwards. Really cool. Here's all these falling down melodies again.
I don't know how to feel.
Yeah. If we were to draw a line through the notes and you were to kind of see the melodic, even without being able to read music, if we were to draw a line through all the notes in this melody, everything just climbs up a little and then falls down. Climbs up a little and falls down. It's really, really beautiful. Then we go to our kind of like outro verse. And I find like there's an interesting cue in the chorus, this last little bit here, or the, not chorus, but this phrase. We have one more repetition. We have one more repetition of that theme D. So in our final verse, it's an A, B, A, B, D, D, D. So in itself, we're ending on this theme D, and we're just kind of like left hanging with this unbalanced melodic fragment. That kind of just disappears off into the distance. Yeah. So interesting that we're not ending with like the chorus part, right? And maybe we could argue that the something I'm made for, that line in itself is a refrain, and that like ending on that is ending on the key theme of the song. But yeah, so we just like used a whole bunch of repetition. The shape of all these melodic lines just kept falling down. There's variations thrown in by Billie, but she tends to keep her verse melody in the song pretty controlled with small variations, and then lets loose in the chorus where the variations always happen at the end of her phrases. We return to key ideas, but there's always a key idea with a variation. So I think to kind of surmise in this song is a masterclass in the power of repetition coupled with variation. And variation wouldn't work if we hadn't had the power of the repeated phrases kind of like really cementing itself in our ears. If there was all this variation and we never had a key theme cemented in our ears, the song wouldn't have a direction. It would just be a meander. On the flip side, if the song was just, you know, few key themes repeated over and over and over again, we might have been bored. It might have felt stale or stagnant. So that's the 1-2 punch, and having them working together really brings a song to life while staying in our ears for the rest of the day, years, life, whatever. I think that's it for me. Thank you all very much. See you next time.